everybody here on behalf of the resident of Laurel Springs, and a little housekeeping duty here, I have to inform you, Laurel Springs is taking no position on this. We've got residents that are for, residents for against, so we just, this is a question and answer session, a learning session from a couple people that are going to speak to us. If Brian Hamm makes it out of the meeting across from the Walmart, he's going to be down here to observe or speak, we don't know which. So first off, I want to introduce Jim Warner, and I'm going to talk about the order of business, the voter engagement, how can you get involved, what can you do? Sign up for a website, go on the Focus on Forsyth website, next door, things like that. Then we're going to talk about the impacts on Forsyth County. And after that, community event, Laurel, why don't we be Sharon Springs? Why can't it just be South Forsyth? That will be discussed. Opposition issues of new cities and an open floor question and answer period. So right now, I'm going to turn it over to Jim. He's going to take it from here.
They said I'm Jim Warner. I'm here. I oppose the city of Sharon. And I'm here.
Hold your mic closer.
I'm here to work toward a goal of defeating. Can't hear me. I'm here to work toward a goal of defeating the referendum that's called for in House Bill 66 in May. My take on it is that we would have to have about 17,000 no votes. And we're cranking up. We didn't mention, they didn't mention, but opposing Sharon Springs people started an initiative to inform the voters, and basically that was this exercise to put information in their hands and also to answer questions and go from there.
Did you hold the mic up, sir?
Right here?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, Jim.
So I got this little piece of paper. Okay. So you know my name. My wife and I have lived here since December of 2000. We're in Long Lake. We moved out here to Alexandria, Virginia, which is a very nice place to live, as it is in Forsyth County. And we moved out here specifically because our grandchildren are here. We have two. When we moved down here, the boy was a year and a half old, and the girl was about 8 months. How they got here is that my son went to Georgia Tech, and he never went back home. He decided he was going to stay down here in the Atlanta area. He has. So that's basically how we got here. Some of the other things that we've done while we've been here, we watched the youth grow up, which was our principal reason for coming. They played a lot of sports. They played in a lot of places. They played at First Redeemer in their sports programs. Very good. They swam with the Creekstone swim team for several years. That was a good exercise. They played on the school teams, went to Big Creek, Piney Grove, Forsyth High School. The boy graduated last year, he's now currently at UGA. The girl graduated this year, she's still thinking about where she's going to college. And we're looking forward to that experience too. Some of the developments that have happened here, and there have been a lot of them since we came. One, the area of Long Lake got finished about 2004. Highway 141 was widened from 2 to 4 lanes, and it's filled up now. There was no Kroger on the corner of Sharon Road and 141 Road. That's here now. There are the parks, the county parks have played a big role in what we've experienced as a family. And now we've got new ones. We've got Fowler Park first. We've got Chattahoochee Point, and then we've got draw important pieces of what's available. One of the other things that occurred, has occurred in the time that we've been here, is that we have the Chamber of Commerce, started, I think, about in 2005. And its report, they put out a report of activities that they did in this past year. And I'd just like to hit on a couple of them. Find it, there it is. They brought in 27 projects into the county. Projects created $167 million in new capital investment. Created 1,364 jobs. This is in 2017. Those projects will pay an estimated $1.7 million in property taxes, which is the equivalent of 1,200 homes. And so they've been doing quite a job. The other thing that deals with what's going on here, I just picked this up. This is a business presentation of, that they do each year. You may be aware of it. The Best of Forsyth is an effort to identify those businesses that are doing well. And there's a lot of them in here, and a lot of them have done well. And there's a lot of good people working hard to make all of these places go together. Now, the reason that I'm telling you this little story is, in my view, I just described a picture of community development, community identity. I think it's very strong. It's always been strong here, and I think it's very strong now. And I'm not sure how it needs to be improved. Okay. Now, I've been active on this new city proposal issue since January of 2014. That's when it first surfaced publicly, and it came out, and I started a writing campaign. I wrote letters to the editor for the Forsyth County News a couple of times. I wrote opinion pieces for the Forsyth County News. I attended all of the town hall meetings on that issue in 2014, and I've been speaking a lot. I also have developed a thing about writing emails. So I write emails, have my opinions in them, point to issues, point to the solutions. To me, the solution of most of what's being talked about is to improve the services that the county gives us, if they need improvement. If they're good enough, we don't need to improve. We don't need to change. So that's basically been my point the whole time. I generate emails. Included on that email list addresses are the Forsyth County State Delegation, which are 7 people, 2 senators, 5 representatives, and the Board of Commissioners. And I just put one out regarding this meeting, and it went to this one. So, periodically, which is about maybe once a quarter, or even less frequently than that, I've been putting this stuff out, up and down the line. About the bill, which is House Bill 626, it started back in 2014, and it went through a couple of years, and then it was the bill was pulled because of some constitutionality issues. And a new bill was introduced at the beginning of 2016 by Representative Todd Jones. That's District 25, which covers most of this area. And that bill has progressed now. It was passed, I think today, is it today? Passed today in the House with a vote of 159-3. So it's gone through that. Next, it goes to the Senate. If it passes out of the Senate, then it goes to the governor for consideration. In the last 6 weeks, basically, I have changed the direction of what I've been doing. I got an invite to this
group of people opposing Sharon Springs. And I looked at what they were doing, and I said, I think that's a group that I can work with, and I joined. And so what my emphasis has been changed from opposing Sharon Springs on the basis of what I consider to be logic and facts and statistics and stuff like that, to one of trying to muster enough support to defeat the main referendum. So I'm not doing the same thing I was doing 3 weeks ago. It's completely different. Okay. Now I want to talk to what my real subject is voter engagement. Basically, what I'm talking about is dealing with the people, the voters, getting them the information that they need so they can understand the issue, recognize the issues first, understand a little bit about it, and make a decision issue by issue as to whether they think there's a basis for saying yes or should they say no. I put on each chair, and I've got four of these. This is what I put together. It's called the Voters' Decision Roadmap. And this has six topics on it and issues under each topic. Topics are city incorporation, talks a little bit about how that mechanics work. The why incorporate a city is an extract from the Senate report that was done and looked at the reasons for people wanting to incorporate. Community identity factors, city staffing and setup. The long and short of that one is that there are, according to the first feasibility study that was done at UGA, there's a total of 24 spaces equivalents involved in setting up the city of Sharon Springs. That's up front. 11 of those spaces are called direct support. That means the planning and zoning, the building inspectors, code enforcement, those kinds of people. 13 of those people are what I would call admin. There's a city clerk, a deputy city clerk, admin, there's a procurement person in there, and odds and ends. Human relations and that, all that kind of stuff. So that's basically the setup. There are a number of regional perspectives which are coming into play now. Namely, that it's going to be more difficult in the coordination between the governmental entities with the more players you have. In the arrangement, there's a lot of things that call for the Forsyth County to do in the city area. There are three, I guess I just didn't mention it, there are three government services to be provided: planning, zoning, building inspection and code enforcement, and then sanitary waste management. And there's about eight others that are on this list here that they don't provide. And the only way they get provided now is that the county does provide it. And if you spend any time looking at the county's website, you'd be amazed at how much they actually have there, and the depth and breadth of services that they do provide. So all of that stuff has to be rearranged. Now, the city is responsible for all of its functions. And so if they have a function, and one of the big topics is road maintenance, there is a state law, which is cited in this paper, that says an incorporated city must maintain what are now called county roads. There's 268 miles of them in this area of Sharon Springs. And the thought was, well, we'll just leave it in the hands of the county. Well, in order to do that, they have to have an intergovernmental agreement. You just don't dump it on Sharon's on Forsyth County and expect them to respond. And there's a whole bunch of intergovernmental agreements that have to be made to make this arrangement go. And it's kind of like a telephone. You go back and forth, and there's a lawyer on each end of the line talking. That helps the cost. I put on here a topic about issues that are outside the box to the proposed city. The two biggest ones that have been talked about in conjunction with this effort are schools, which are an independent authority in the county, and traffic congestion, which is a function of the roads, basically, and the amount of traffic that's coming through. And the line of logic that the people from the Sharon Springs had was that if we get control of planning and zoning, then we can reduce the number of houses that are available, reduce the number of people, and impact the traffic congestion. Well, it turns out in the proposed city area, there's only about 10% of the land area that has not been developed. There's a map in the back that shows how that all breaks down. And when I say it's undeveloped, that means it's agriculture as opposed to some other use. So that's how that squares away. Now, I'm getting there. There's a bunch of little jars sitting around in some places, and it has what I call a voter ticket on it. And that's what the voter ticket says, basically. And the whole gist of this effort that I'm talking about is to try to raise enough interest and understanding of what the issues are with this city that the referendum goes down in a blaze of glory with about 17,000 no votes. And if that happens, I'm very happy. Okay. Thank you. I've either covered everything I was going to cover, or I might have forgot something. But that basically, those are the stories that I wanted to tell you. I'll talk a little bit more about community identity. That's what I was talking about when I was talking about what my experience has been here. We're talking about the community very strong. We've been involved in a lot of different pieces of it. There are a couple of pieces that have been discussed that I didn't touch on. One has to do with the postal zip codes. Up in this area, I think we're all in 30041. If you go down into the southeastern part of the county, you're dealing with different zip codes there. 3024, and I think there's 30005 is another one. And there's
97.
The thought is, if you had a city, maybe the city could work something out so we had one zip code. I don't think we could leverage a post office to do that.
We can't hear you.
Okay. Because I have to stick this in my mouth.
How's that? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
What's that? So that's part of what the community identity is. There's also an effort that the county just started working on to try to come up with a character description that fits the whole of Sharon Springs. And I would only say that we have a lot of different kinds of characters in the community neighborhoods, subdivisions that we have. And frankly, I don't think they're comparable. I know the subdivision I imagine is different than most of the other ones that I know of. And the idea that you can put one size fits all on the character of these different areas, I think, is just a non-starter. So that's part of the community identity issue. That's not a big point for me, but it gets a lot of discussion.
Thank you.
comment?
I noticed on that first study that came out, 2015, they talked about if the city went through, the impact on the county would be quite substantial, to the point that they would have to increase taxes to make up the differential of the income that they would lose from Sharon Springs, anywhere from 7 to 12%. You've been to the meetings, is that accurate?
I can tell you that that is coming out of the latest study that Georgia State just did for the county. I think it was 6 to 11, but your numbers are 7 to 12. That's just an increase in the taxes because of revenue that the county will lose, which would go to Sharon Springs. And the amount of money that the county doesn't incur, the expense the county doesn't incur because of the movement of these few spaces that I talked about, it shows a big differential between those two. And I'm thinking, I haven't read the new study in detail, but I'm thinking it's about, say, $1 million of expenses the county won't incur, and they're giving up $6 million. So, $4 or $5 million there. Sure.
In a discussion with somebody who is on the for Sharon Springs side, they were throwing around a number of 7,500 acres that they were wanting to basically take control of zoning, and they're talking about a zoning reset, having a reset capability with the new city to possibly change already approved projects. Is that something that you've heard people batting around?
I have not heard it.
No. Okay.
They may be talking. I've not heard it. Yes, sir.
How about a question from the House? You talked about the vote that you said it passed 159-3. Can you tell us how our state representatives that actually represent the area included in the city voted?
I can't tell you. I don't know. All I got is a total number of the vote, and I haven't seen details about that yet.
All right, follow-on question. Can you tell us when the first Senate vote will be? Because it sounds like if we're going to do anything here, we need to start getting in touch with representatives or senators ASAP, letting them know where we stand.
I don't have any dates, but the process will be, and I don't even know the name of the committee, it'll go into a Senate committee for that. And I guess we can make this information, we can find this information out and make it available. But it goes through the committee. If it passes out of the committee, then it goes to the Senate for a vote. And there may be more than one committee in the Senate. That's another point, I don't know. If the Senate passes the bill, then it goes to the governor. If the governor signs it, the bill becomes law, and this referendum is part of that law. So we're facing a May 8th for the referendum.
Today on the latest from, I was just down at the senator's office 2 days ago, and the consensus from the ones in this area are that they just want to push it through so that we can vote on it. And they said if we got 57% of the population in this area to vote for it, then they would say that that's good enough. So the majority of the ones down there were saying we just want to push it through and let y'all vote on it, basically.
I guess I would make a comment on that. There was a study committee that went through this summer. It consisted of 12 members, one each from our legislative delegation, and a person appointed by the legislative delegation, and a person from each of our commissioners. They spent from May until October reviewing, talking to people, and doing that kind of thing. I made a presentation to that committee, basically told them the history, which I told you some of the history tonight. That presentation was a PowerPoint presentation, and if you go to opposingsharonsprings.com, you can find that, and you can see what I told them. And I've reviewed it since, and I'll stand by all the words that I put into it. So the problem that I saw from the study committee is that the original name was that it was going to be a feasibility study committee. And I said, that's good. That's what we need. The only thing is, when you change, in when you walk away from what feasibility study means, which to me, it means you identify benefits and costs, and you can make decisions on what's the benefit, how much does it cost, should I do this or shouldn't I? That to me is a feasibility study. That's not what the study committee came up with. And I told them this, point blank. If you read it, you can see a lot of subjects that they addressed in the course of it. You can see a lot of this and that and back and forth and all the rest of it. But nowhere in that report does it come to any conclusions about anything. And at the end of this, the consideration of this, they changed the topic or the subject, if you will, for feasibility study to let the people vote. And I said, wow, what happened? They just changed the whole thing. It's a different, completely different way. And I can't imagine the people in business would take that choice. But if you're a politician, I guess it makes it easy to do that. So that's a little thought on the study. I was very disappointed in the results of that. I'm very disappointed in the vote that came in today from the House. Only three people opposed it. I'd like to find out who they are and go shake their hand. So, anybody else got a question or comment?
Let me ask you, our commissioners, what commissioners are involved in this new city? I know Laura Samotson is, because she's my county commissioner. Who else is involved? You know?
Well, of the county commissioners?
Yes.
Well, there's five.
No, I understand that, but involved in the city, who have residents in their district that will encompass this city, and the question is what is their support? Do they oppose it, or are they proponents of it? And what are they doing relative to getting the word out? They represent us.
I can give you.
But I got another question. I want to follow up on what we do. But go ahead.
If I was to give you a straw poll on the commissioner now, I'd say four oppose it, and your commissioner is the only one that supports it.
So Matson supports it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so we've got a hurdle to overcome, because that's a big part of it. I live in Windermere, and of course Windermere Freeway runs right through Windermere, and I now call it freeway because it's not a parkway. And the traffic that is running down Windermere Freeway are not Windermere residents; they're coming out of Gwinnett County. And can you imagine? Whenever we open up 20 with four lanes, with two lanes turning on the Windermere Freeway, we've had two deaths already this year on Windermere Freeway. How many deaths are we going to have if we don't? As I tried to get Laura Samotson to support roundabouts on Windermere Freeway just to slow the traffic down. Now here's the deal. In my neighborhood, in my residence, and I send this notice out, you know what they respond to me is? George, those in the north, those commissioners in the north, they don't care about what happens here in the south and the growth. George, it's all about growth and traffic. And they're saying anything we can do to fix the unbridled growth and the traffic that's going to kill our individuals, our neighbors, we must fix. And here's why I say that to it. If we're going to change this whole deal, if we're going to oppose it, and if it is not good, then we must have the right message. The deal is, if we don't have a city which has been sold as the answer to unbridled growth and horrible traffic and growth on schools, overcrowded schools, if we don't have the answer of what we do that without the city, my neighbors are going to vote yes for it, and I can't change their mind. We must have a plan, a real plan of what are we going to do with our county officials to do the right thing. There must be a plan. Because here's what my mom used to say. She used to say, George, if you always continue, she said, the definition of insanity, and you've heard this before, is to keep doing what you've always done and to get no result. Now we've been talking about this unbridled growth for how long? And nothing's happening. Now, I'm not selling, let's do it. Please don't. I don't have an opinion right now. I understand you're opposing it. I don't have an opinion, but we have to do something to change the agenda, or everyone, all of my neighbors are going to vote yes, and I can't change their mind.
My name is J. Joe Moses, and I was a planning commission for this district for 4 years up until 2 years ago. There's been some recent developments from the county commissioner's work session that they had Tuesday. I would recommend that you go on the Forsyth County website, go to the meetings, and look at the February the 6th Board of Commissioners work session. You'll see there where the commissioners stand on this. First off, the commissioners don't really have a say-so in what's going to happen. It's up to the state, as you can see. Dennis Brown, at that meeting, who is commissioner for District 2, said that he's hardly talked to anybody who's in favor of the new city. And he said that in public Tuesday. Also, Ken Girard, our Forsyth County attorney, presented a correspondence that he got Tuesday morning from Todd Jones, which was stating that the folks for the city, or that are proposing the city, are wanting to negotiate some concessions from the county in return for them not pushing the bill or pulling the bill out. So the pro Sharon Springs crowd is probably having second thoughts. My opinion is that it will never pass, especially having to reach a 57.5% threshold. I don't have a problem with the vote because I don't think it'll pass, and that should bring it all to an end. I hope that the county doesn't negotiate, because I don't think it's going to pass anyway. That's my opinion. But the fact that Todd has sent a letter to the county wanting to see if they can get concessions. After all this stuff about saying they want to vote, now all of a sudden this unknown Sharon Springs, so we don't know who they are. I've got copies of all the LLCs that are behind all this stuff, but there are very few names associated, so we don't really know who the people are. It's really not transparent at all. I guess that's about it, but I would recommend that you go to the county website, get on the meeting.
Can I ask you a question? Yes, a lot of the people here think that the sales point about Sharon Springs is that effectively the government and Forsyth screwed up in the past. They let unbridled growth continue. And since you were hands-on,
I didn't have a part. I stood up. It was generally for the
one vote. Who explained to us about how that happened? I'm under the impression that some of the commissioners have ideas and vested interests, financial interests, in seeing this growth continue. Either their lawyers or land, they have large quantities of land available to them. Is that the only reason, or is it that just the characteristics of having to give and take?
Part of the reason is that when somebody comes in and asks for a zoning change, a developer particularly, they always have an attorney. And state law is written so that it's hard for a county to prevent rezonings of your own property, because Georgia is a property rights state. And if you own the property, the feeling is that you should be able to do what you want to with your own property. And if you want to sell it to a big developer, you should be able to do that. And generally, the homeowners that are being affected generally are not represented by attorneys and at the meetings. And so that's one of the reasons it fails. Now, the people who are in charge of that are your state representatives again. I agree that some of the commissioners have not taken care of the whole county like they should, but if you've noticed, we're having a change in some of our commissioners, as well as, for the better, as well as the city council coming. So I think that we're going to have a little bit more transparency in our government coming up than we've had. That sort of answers.
The zoning people can put additional conditions on the property to make it very unattractive.
Let me tell you how that works. This is a real pet peeve of mine, is when everybody is at the meetings, the commission meeting or the planning commission meeting, everybody's there to put conditions on the zonings. 6 months later, when all the furor has gone away, the developer comes back with their lawyer. Nobody is in the audience, and they ask to change the conditions, and they get changed. And that's been going on for years.
And that's like off in Old Alabama.
What?
Off Old Alabama Road, where they...
Is that the way they did it there?
Yeah, they started out with big houses with big property on them. And now they just switched the zone. They're going to put cluster homes.
And they come
with duplexes in.
Yeah, and it's real frustrating because they come back when the residents think they've won.
And that backs up. And
it's never over. They just come. And they've been doing that for years, the commission. I'm not trying to take over the meeting.
Why don't you step over here so they can hear you over there?
How about a nuts and bolts question? And this might be something to answer the gentleman back here. And help me with my math and make my understanding of things. A 0.5 mil tax, so let's just use a round number. If someone has a $1 million home, does that mean you're paying $5,000 extra a year in tax?
It's a half a mil on the assessed value of the house, which is 40% roughly of the market value.
All right, so 40%. So then if it's a $1 million home, 40% of that is $400,000, half a mil, then is $2,000 a year you're gonna be paying extra in tax. True?
I think
that
is
your math
right.
That's
all right.
Yeah. That's until they need money. And what happens to the homestead exemption for the people who are over 65?
Well, homestead is for school, right? This is private school. So it sounds to me that in addition to.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
I mean, I haven't heard too many for folks, just as the gentleman here was talking about, and I'm willing to listen to things. I've heard the issue of, hey, we want to cut down on traffic, we want to cut down on development. But I guess the question I'm asking my mind is, if you're an elected official for the county representing a certain area, and now we change the title and you become an elected official for a new city in the same area.
Now
that you pay $2,000 a year extra, what guarantee do you have that that's going to change the vote of that elected official one iota?
He goes, what?
Good question.
Yeah.
I think it's in this hand on paper I have. The city government is proposed consists of six council members and a mayor. The way they've broken it down, each resident in the city would have to vote for five of those people at some point in time. And the way it works is they have three districts that have a permanent representative, say. Then, and also from each of those districts, they have an at-large council member. So you get, and the council members, you get one plus three. And you got to vote for the mayor. So that's five people you got to vote for. I don't need to know that many people voting for it. I would like to say one thing about the discussion that was here before, and that has to do with the way this
legislative. The way this process is working, whether you like it or not, is the way the law is written. And the law says that in order to incorporate a city, you start with state legislation. Essentially, what you have is the state legislature and the representative there working on doing things in the county, and the interaction with the county is not part of the game. That's the way the law reads. I took, in one of these emails that I was talking about, I took exception with that. I think that's wrong. I think that one of the things is that the people who get the vote on this city are only the people in this area. The fact that it impacts the whole county doesn't count. I think that's wrong. That's a process. It's a state. And I've told the same people I was talking about that that's what I think. I don't know if that'll ever go anywhere. That's part of the problem. If you don't work with somebody, you don't have to work with them, you work around them. And that's what's been happening on this thing for 4 years. Another question.
In the back here.
I understand that we get a city, that we pay more taxes. What do we get in return? We, the taxpayers.
Nothing.
You pay taxes.
More taxes.
More taxes. Taxes in the city and how and through.
What you're asking is taxes increase, what benefits do you get in return for that?
That's what I was talking about moving with full attention. Nobody has looked at the benefits and how much it's going to cost to get those benefits and whether or not you want the benefits. That's completely great. That's pretty great too. Nobody has laid down on a piece of paper and said these are the benefits that we expect to have, and this is what it's going to cost. That's the feasibility study that I was talking about. It's not been done. Yes, sir.
So I've lived in Atlanta my entire life, and I went through the annexation of Sandy Springs. My parents still live there. They've lived there since 1986. I'm not saying for or against, right? But some things that we need to think about, for and against, involve things like, and a lot of people don't understand, that when the federal government hands out money for roads, the county itself is required to spend equal dollars to match that. Well, we have all of this growth that's happening here. 90% of the land has already been given approval for building. The roads are going to have to be built. I like this gentleman's, George, is that?
Right.
I liked your thought on the roundabouts to slow some traffic down and some of the benefits of having smaller government are that your voice can, not will, can be heard more in that, and they have a local theme of that. But I don't know that we can really get away from putting more roads in and expanding, because the building has already been permitted. Again, you know, you would have a better understanding of whether that can be undone, but it's not going to be easily undone, right? People just come back when nobody's paying attention. So the roads have to be expanded. And for every dollar that the federal government gives each county, so if we become Sharon Springs, we are now liable and responsible for laying of all of that road, and $1 per dollar goes to match it. Where's that revenue coming from? A much smaller number of people, okay? Sandy Springs is 91,000 people. Last study I saw here shows 50,000 people. Their taxes have already gone up. Have they seen better benefits? Yes, they have. They're seeing more patrol of police officers. They said every 6 minutes, they're seeing people within their local area from police in Sandy Springs. You can't say no.
No, that's not part of what this would be. We would not have our own police.
I'm just giving, I said I'm not pro or against. Mm-hmm. We don't have enough information.
Mm-hmm.
To
One of the downsides, though.
It's hard to compare Fulton County Commission running Sandy Springs than Forsyth County Commission.
Look, I absolutely agree. I mean, I'm going to a city plan. I'm just telling you that I come from it within a little bit of time.
I know all about Sandy Springs.
The other thing to consider is, you know, again, getting back to our commissioners, sometimes you get the benefit of a smaller community because people will sometimes listen more. On the other side, they also then get more power. So there's not always, you know, as with everything, you know, no good deed goes unpunished. So just little things to think about. From, we all know that there's going to be higher taxes. What are the benefits to your question? What are those benefits? We can fix some of the issues. One of my concerns is the crowding in the schools. We can fix that real easy. All we need to do is verify that people actually live at the address by asking for, you know, bills at the property. We're not doing that. It was required in Fulton County. I had to prove that every single year and bring three different bills. So a lot of little things that can be fixed. But I will say, to sit on the side and not have a voice and assume it won't go through and not have a plan and a clear message of why no is a real mistake. Because
if you had this many people show up at those county commission meetings, there would already have been a great deal of influence about the growth and how that was being handled. Whether it's approved now and 6 months later, there's a change. If we were there 6 months later, there wouldn't be that much change going on. We need to have that kind of voice. I think George is right. We've got to have some kind of plan that says, if you think this is a bad idea, what do we do to fix it?
They wear you down, though. They'll get it postponed.
Well,
but you don't go and tell somebody this XYZ is a bad idea, right? And have no solution to it. Mm-hmm. Right? Because then you just look like you're complaining, and that's just your methodology. So I would encourage you to really think about it, at where the issues are and what you want fixed. But realize, again, the growth is already here. We're going to have to deal with the roads. And that is going to be a mega undertaking in infrastructure. And the cost that will be passed on to every one of us. So that's all.
I want to just jump in just quickly and add to that. Our commission, Laura Samantzen is my commissioner. I voted for her. I supported her. She should be supporting us, all of our commission. We should have, I'm surprised she's not here. Where are you, Laura?
Probably in the food bar.
There's a couple of other people.
But we should have her here, and she should be sending out messages to us, letting us know. She should have an opinion. And we should demand that of her. I agree with you. We don't have to go. It's great to go in those meetings. I've been in meetings and made presentations against attorneys relative to zoning and have won. But all I'm saying is that's fine. But we should be asking our commissioners who represent us to show up and tell us why this is, and answer the question. You got to have a solution, right, sir? So, Laura, what are you going to do? Now, I asked her those questions, but I'm one individual. And even though, if you look on her website, she talks about her communications degree and what a great communicator she is, but she isn't with me. We should have her show up and communicate with us. Is that asking too much?
No.
Of course not. That's what. But I'm with you. Here's the deal. We got to stop doing what we've always done. We got no results. And we got to have a solution. This man is so right. We must have an answer. And it must be very well presented. If you go present, as this gentleman said earlier, against the zoning, you better have a plan. You're going to be against an attorney there with a $2,000 suit on.
Sir, there has been some talk with the county with something called an IPN. It's something similar. Is it like a township? Although townships are considered illegal in Georgia. But I've heard a few of the commissioners starting to rumble and talk about creating IPNs within like different parts of Forsyth County, which would be like a Vinings or a Buckhead or something like that, which is something to reach out to Laura about. That would be my suggestion.
Down on both sides of
the road at Brookwood is owned by this Suwanee has taken it over. They want to build townhomes, They even talked about movie theaters and grocery stores. How much traffic we're going to have from that?
Well, you know, ma'am, just a side note, there's a church on Brookwood that's been there over 100 years.
Right.
And you call it eminent domain, call it what you want, it's just not right. The road now is going to go right up against the door of a church that's been right there over 100 years.
Exactly.
I don't care if you're religious or not, that's just not right.
That's where I live.
Exactly.
Right, on that road, Brookwood. They're going to be four lanes. You talk about the traffic coming from Gwinnett and Mathis Airport Road. That's my road that continues on down.
Okay, we're going to hear from California.
Okay, I'm showing you now. But we bought a home in Spokane a year ago, and we moved out here.
Can't hear you.
We moved out from here. Well, I'm the enemy for the California.
Don't pull apart.
Well, the interesting thing about this for me is that, I mean, everyone is, I mean, I love Georgia, and everyone's so passionate about the community, and you're seeing the great things about people moving into the area, and then you're seeing the really bad things about people moving in, because you know, I live on Stone Gate, and someone's going to kill themselves on Mathis and Beachview Parkway every day, and obviously there should be lights there. But I will tell you that if you don't have all your answers right now, because I don't even begin to know, all I know is that taxes, I lived in a town outside of San Francisco in a 1,600 square foot home, which is like a $150,000 house here, that was worth 1.15. Yes, we were house poor all the time, and our taxes went up to $12,000 a year. So if you're looking at taxes and talking right now about, well, maybe it could be $2,000 more on a $1 million home, and I live in a $400,000 home, and we don't have the 65 exemption now, which was a huge reason to want to come this way, to think about, wow, it'd be great not to be tax poor as we were before. And so where the taxes would be like 954, that's what they'll be if it was the same, okay? When my husband turned 65 next year. But this year, they're around 4,600. Okay, now if that goes up another 1,000, I mean, just start to think that if it's $2,000 more on a $1 million home, or if it's $1,000 more, this is going to keep snowballing. Mm-hmm. So the answer, I don't know what the answer is, but I can say that I think the power of one is incredible, like this man who stands up and you feel his passion, and you all love your community, and you're seeing all this come in. You see the good, and you see the bad of it, and you can't expect somebody else to really represent you. So when there are these meetings, all these people came in and you said, no, that's not happening in my house next to my road. And you're going to have to keep fighting, because this thing is a runaway train right now. You're not going to just if a city comes in and someone says, oh, it'll be fabulous, we're going to be able to make all these changes. You've got stuff that's been planned that's coming in, and it isn't going to stop like this. I mean, I have lived through this before. It will get away from you so quickly. So all these people, we really don't know what's going to happen, and this is 2 or 3 months away. Obviously, this thing shouldn't be going through right now, because there isn't enough. We don't know enough. And now people are seeing their day-to-day lives being influenced by the traffic and these things that have changed in their communities with their schools and everything else, to the point now where you're like, I've got to stand up and say something. I care, you know, you care about it, and we're all here enough to do that. So my only 2 cents for you on all this is that taxes can break your back unbelievably like nothing you've ever known. And at 65, to be able to live in a wonderful county that has that option, is where I'm sure a lot of you, you know, are in that position where you think, well, what am I going to do if my taxes, you know, what if we don't have the 65 and over exemption anymore? Okay, it's toast for a lot of people. So then we're all going to move. We're going to have to move, and you live in your communities forever. So it's just some things to think about. If you don't think that it can get crazy, I could never retire in California. But $12,000 a year. I mean, a little tiny house. And I see that it's going to happen. And the houses will get smaller and smaller. The houses will get smaller. because people have to be able to afford the taxes. And in order to do that, they can't have land, right? Because the land's going to be taxed. So it's just some additional things to think about.
I'm just wondering, is there anybody here that would be willing to stand up and vocalize what the benefits are for a Sharon Spring city? Is there anybody here that would do that?
That's an open question. I'll tell you, it's not me.
Well, is there anybody?
It's an open question for anybody to stand up and vocalize what they think the benefits of the new city would be.
Then my question is, how did it get this far?
No, stay with my question.
Oh, okay, your question first, and then how did it get this far?
And I'm going to take 10 minutes to ask that question and see what I have.
So from the website and the discussions that I've had with people about it, they're saying that they want to be able to reset zoning decisions and making it a city. It's their belief that they can do a reset on zoning decisions and basically renegotiate with developers to get things the way that they want them and reduce density. They're talking about not being governed from afar, as if downtown Cumming is so far away that they're making decisions from across 400, God forbid. And those were the main things that were articulated as I was asking questions about was resetting zoning.
Is there anybody here that would speak to why the benefits of this?
I have a question, George. George, when you were talking about that people in your area would just go with it, what do they tell you? What, like your neighbors? What are they telling you?
If I get to it, I can do that. My good neighbor sent me a note back, and here's what he said. He said, the advantages of the new township, as I see it, would be the ability for Sharon Spring residents to have more say in what happens in our community. Today, the county commissioners vote on initiatives for the entire county. The needs and desires of the residents in the northern part of the county are very different from those in the southern part. We are seeing too much growth in the southern half of the county. Biggest issue, folks, I'm telling you. This growth is clogging our roads and destroying our green spaces. The growth is also allowing all sorts of poorly zoned businesses to be built up throughout the southern half of the county. The commissioners for the northern half of the county can care only about the revenue this growth brings because they do not have to live in the middle of this mess.
And who was that?
That was my neighbor.
Your neighbor?
My neighbor. Now, most of my neighbors on my street, we got our own little neighbor. But I know them all, and I sent them all an email saying there was a meeting tonight. They said, I don't have an opinion. Give me your opinions. That was one of the opinions. But everyone is saying to me, as I said earlier, I'm being redundant, but Georgia's about growth, overcrowding of schools, okay, and having, and traffic. And I tell you, and I've said this to our HOA, Windermere's HOA, and I say it to everyone, Windermere Parkway is Windermere Freeway. We've had two deaths. And if when they open it up, if we don't slow it down, we're going to have multiple deaths on Windermere Freeway.
But that's not going to be changed. Now, that's not going to be changed by a city. That's not going to be changed by a city.
I understand. I agree with that. I'm just telling you what's being sold.
So
what's being sold is that.
So how do we put a plan together in a story?
Well, we've got to have a plan. This gentleman said it. We have to have a plan of how we get to the county. And we have meetings. And we ask our commissioners to come and meet with us and help us and support us and develop a plan. We must develop a plan that says if we're not going to have the city that they have sold it as, we must in fact have a solution. Am I wrong? We have to have it, or it's going to go through. Now, I know this gentleman said 57 votes and he'd love to have it. I don't believe it. Not if I know my neighbors. Because they're so angry of the growth of we're filling up our schools. They're so angry about Gwinnett County people driving 70 miles an hour down our parkway.
Well, your neighbors benefited from the growth. Somebody sold that property at one time.
If we're opposed to this, is there not a way to go to the Senate and stop it before we have to go through a
But it's going to
be on the city. Is going to?
Yeah, we know the
Todd Jones. Who's the guy that he lives in Creeks? Is Todd Jones?
It's Todd Jones.
He's about neutral on it. And he said, here's the deal. They've got it down. They've got it very articulate. They've got their story down and said it's about controlling the land use. It's about having a voice and it's about having a branding. Those are the top three things that they're having a very good story about.
The horse has left the farm.
That's oh, it's right. Long gone. Yes. But they're very articulate about it. And the reality is, I think that this is a good start. I don't know if it's too late, but you're not going to stop what they've already created. And the senators down there have said, we hear them loud and clear, and we think that the only way that we're going to appease things is to go ahead and put it to vote with the residents there. But I will tell you this, the branding part of it, our area is already branded. I'm in real estate. If you cross-section off Forsyth into four areas and you use 20 as a dividing thing and 400, this is the highest dollar per home that you'll find out there. So we have been branded already. It's Southeast Forsyth. We just don't have a label of something like Sharon Springs, but our school district is the best, considered the best. And so I think that we need to get some people together that are wanting to put a good message out there that's congruent and can compete against them. I'm one that I wanted to find out more information, and by coming here tonight, I'd say I'm about in the middle, because we do need to have more control over things. The traffic is ridiculous around here. But if there was a way that we could work something out that could appease them without having to increase our taxes, I think that would be a good win-win. And I think that the senators would be willing to listen to something in regard to that.
I think you're coming in. I would just say this, and I say it just as a direct observation, that in the 4 years that I've worked following this effort, there has been very little cooperation or willingness to work with anybody. And that's talking to the commissioner, people in the Sharon Springs thing. I talked to Dennis Brown, our commissioner, the day before yesterday. He's been trying to contact them for quite a while. He says he can't make any contact with them. That's kind of strange. But it's been that way for the whole time, from my observation. Commissioners have been bypassed on this thing. Nobody's tried to engage the county in improvements. As a matter of fact, this goes way back. In the original session that we had at Long Lake, which was April of 2014, one of the residents there asked the speaker from Sharonsburg, if you see things that need to be improved, why don't you work with the county to improve them? And the answer was, we're not going to do that. You can do that, but we're not going to. That's true. Bill's still here?
I'd like to speak too.
Okay, let me get Bruce here first. You want to use this thing or just
not? I have a big voice, so I, but, you know, understand both sides of the situation. Many of us are seniors here. I don't know what percentage of the county is seniors, but necessarily many of us moved to this area to get the discount on our taxes, right? It was a big incentive to move here, okay? The issue is, when you moved in, did you expect that nobody else was gonna move in after you? I mean, come on. Well, on one side, we're incentivized. We have an incentive to move here. Okay, on the other hand, you're complaining that people are moving here. So I understand you're between a rock and a hard place, okay? What you want to do is control the, you know, and they talk about schools. I mean, we all want good schools for our grandchildren or our children if we have them later in life, and that's fine, okay? We need to balance it, because if reality, we also don't want the fact that nobody comes to this county, and the issue really is, you know, it would implode on itself. So, you know, you're not getting, all of us have different reasons for being. You know, some people want different traffic patterns. I don't want, you know, additional expenses in taxes on, you know, on my home. Okay, so we all have something different, but we're all against Sharon Springs coming here or incorporating here. So, you know, we have to come up with a plan to basically say we want
it to stay the same, because that's the way it is, and we're going to work with the county to make these X number of improvements. We have this complaint, we can't really say what we're going to do, and this is this gentleman's comment before. We don't know what we're going to do, so what's our plan? Okay? You know, I don't mind having some growth, but I also don't want to have, you know, when my son doesn't take a job down to 285 because he can't get there going down 400, that's a problem, okay? We all have traffic in Atlanta. We're always going to have traffic in Atlanta. We want to be able to balance it in reality, okay? So just, you know, don't expect that this group is going to make the world of changes and all of a sudden things are going to stop and we're going to have it just the way each individual one of us want to have it. So just be realist.
Let me make a comment on the transportation. Nobody's mentioned it, and I forgot to say it. The county is working on an update to the transportation plan now. We just finished getting citizen input, I think, at the end of last month. I don't have a real good feel of where that is going, but that chart that's on that near post over there has on it an overlay of where projects are. Yeah, right behind but there is some work going on in the transportation plan, but I just don't know what it is.
Joe is actually online on Forsyth County. You can find the chart for transportation. It shows all the plans for highways, roads, and updates and what they have planned now. In addition to that, it shows you the projected growth over the next 10 years. It's online on Forsyth County.
I got this fellow up here waiting for. This is for old people.
I got a question to start with. And I got here late because I was at the wrong clubhouse. That's my fault. The number that we're talking about the increase in taxes from the city, from the new city, and are those numbers from the Georgia Tech study or are they from the new Georgia State study?
The numbers that I saw, and I did not study the Georgia State study that just came out, but the number that I saw was that the tax would increase, I believe it was 6 to 11%.
Yeah, the Georgia Tech study said 7.5 to 12.5.
No, the new study was 6.2 to 10.6, I think it is. That's the new study that came out February 5th. And that shows the effect of what happens to those that are in Forsyth County, no longer in the city area.
Can I ask a question on that? 6.2 to 10.6% of what?
That's an increase in their ad valorem tax.
Ad valorem tax?
Yes. Increase
property taxes. Is that the average for residents within the proposed city that are going to be
paying? Entire county.
So in other words, so a whole bunch of Forsyth County that pays nothing extra
and has no voice.
Right.
No voice.
They don't have any voice in our area.
We've got a voice.
But
they don't have a voice.
But that means we proportionally, though, in this much smaller section, are probably not paying 6.whatever to 10.6. Since all those zeros are in there, we're probably paying 30% or 40% for the residents within.
How much does the city county do today?
Have you ever seen taxes go down?
Apartment?
No, I've never had. I agree with you.
Okay, so we'll take
how much do they pay in addition to
live
in the city of county versus
Forsyth
County?
That's the 25 million limit. Is that correct? I can't really answer this question.
Is your question about coming?
Yes.
She wants the millage rate in coming. And
I have that salary calculator.
I think you will find it. If you look at it, probably find that the millage rate in coming is zero. Because they make money off selling water.
Yes. Oh, yes. The city and county has no water. They sell water to us. Primarily, and that's what is their big subsidy.
And don't forget, it's lost money as well. But there's
beat, I will call it, or what they wanted to accomplish when they first got organized. And this comes from January 21st, 2014. Overcrowded schools, green space, air and water quality, traffic, rampant development, and very little representation with current five board seat members. So I'd like to make a brief comment about each of those. Overcrowded schools. New schools have been opened, and significant improvement has been made on this issue. Now, there's been a lot of redistricting going on, a lot of people unhappy about that, but as far as overcrowding itself goes, there's been a lot of alleviation of that problem. That has nothing to do with Sharon Springs Alliance. It has to do with the availability of state funds for building new schools, plus county funds for building new schools, and they're on the planning board. You can get that same information from the Board of Education. Green space. We had a 2008 Parks, Recreation, and Green Space bond, which raised $100 million. We as voters, through a referendum, voted to approve that $100 million, which we're going to have to repay. And we're going to have to repay the interest on that. How do we do that? We increase our own taxes. We voted to do it. I don't mind doing that one little bit, because there is a specific purpose for it, and it benefits all of us. Air and water quality. I'm not sure exactly what that means, but it could mean clear cutting for new development throughout the county. And if you clear cut, you take down the trees, you decrease the air quality, and you create more stormwater problems than you had before. So that's what that may mean, but I can't speak to that directly. Traffic. In 2014, we had a transportation bond, which raised $200 million. By the way, I worked on both those bond issues with Brian Tam to try to get those passed. The transportation bond raised $200 million. There are 35 projects today being worked on or have been completed as a result of that traffic and transportation bond. 35. 18 of those are in the area of the Sharon Springs city. 18 out of 35, that's 52%. The current SPLOST has 33 projects underway, and 17 of those are within the Sharon Springs city area, another 52% of those funds. All right, so we get complaints about traffic's awful. Well, folks, Atlanta's moving here. I started out in what used to be known as Buckhead, not Buckhead now, but went from Buckhead to Sandy Springs to Roswell and now here. And a couple of years ago, I said, I'm going to die here. There's no doubt about it. I feel so great. It's a wonderful place to live. Well, just don't push me too far. So, tremendous amount of improvement in the roads. We've had improvements in the schools. All right, rampant development. Have we had rampant development? Yes, we have. We had many rezonings in the early 2000s, and then the recession came along, and a lot of those things got put on the shelf. We then started experiencing what many of you know as PVC farms or pipe farms. They were all over the place. They're gone. Those places have been redeveloped, foreclosure, redeveloped. Now they're being built out. They're being sold to the end users, and those people have come into our county and are now paying taxes. Has that been overdeveloped? You can say that it has. It's a matter of density. We look at high density in Forsyth County as being something like 6 units to the acre. Just go 3 miles that way into Forsyth, into Fulton County, and 20 units acre is in high density. 20 units. Going to Gwinnett, DeKalb, Fulton, all of those have multiple multifamily developments that easily get into the 20 per unit without going 20 units to the acre without going high rise. Those are garden apartments. My business throughout my life has been in commercial real estate. I have financed over over $1 billion of apartment development throughout the southeastern U.S. I got a little experience, you might say, in that field. People say to me, I don't want apartments, I hate apartments, I can't stand apartments. They're going to turn over, they're going to get in disrepair, and bad people are going to move in there, and there's going to be a lot of crime. Well, that's not necessarily true. It's just not necessarily true. Does that happen? Yes, it does. Does it happen in single-family neighborhoods? Yes, it does. We have to maintain what we build. Next thing I would like to say in regard to that is that our comprehensive plan talks about density and that we need to reduce it in order to maintain the character of Forsyth County. And I would say that that's a correct statement if we want to maintain the character of Forsyth County and make it different from Fulton County or DeKalb County or Gwinnett County. It is different. I like it that way. Should we increase density from where it is today? I would say no. Should it be decreased? I think it is, quote, the will of the people that it be done that way. We look at the new comprehensive plan for 2017 through 2037, and that is what the people of this county want. They want reduced density. I'm not against that. I'm absolutely not against it. It's going to take a lot of effort. It's going to take a lot of changes in the UDC, Unified Development Code, in order to do that so that rezonings can be changed or the zoning laws can be changed so that when people go to get a rezoning, they are not violating laws in order to do so. Parks. We have 26 parks in the county, and 9 of them are in the Sharon Springs area. 9 out of 26. We've got the best that our county has to offer already. And if we want to change to a new government and add another layer of government onto it, then I say that's the wrong way to go. I'm saying, and I have said from the outset, and I said it at the same meeting Jim mentioned at the Long Lake Clubhouse. If we want to change things, let's change it at the ballot box. Let's don't change our system of government. It works, and it's been working very well. Is it perfect? No. Is it going to be perfect? No. Can we better it? Maybe we can. We also had an opportunity several years ago to change the way commissioners were voted upon. And we changed it to a district-only voting. Well, now that's what folks are complaining about, district-only voting. The district commissioner and commissioner 5, I'm not going by name, but you know who they are. They don't care what goes on in District 2. Tell me that's not correct. I don't know what's going on in District 2 and don't care, but I'm going to vote on it anyway. No, that's not right. In order for a rezoning to be introduced, is the gentleman from the Planning Commission still here? Yeah. Former gentleman?
Yes.
In order to get a motion on the floor to get a rezoning introduced, it requires the introduction by the district in which the zoning is located. And they have to make a motion for or against. And then it goes to the rest of the planning commissioners who vote on it. And by the way, they have absolutely no authority whatsoever. None. That takes it to the Board of Commissioners with a vote yay or nay on that particular zoning issue. and the zoning commissioner, the board commissioner from that district goes through the same process as the planning commission, and they can say yay or nay on their motion or make changes. And they can change anything in there they want to change as long as the board of commissioners votes on it. That's what happens. Now, I'm looking at a particular zoning that comes out of staff, and I've been working on it now for several years, and I'm against it. And it comes out of the staff with a favorable ruling and goes to the planning commission unfavorable. Fine with me, let's change it. They got 65 conditions on that rezoning. 65. Is that an invitation to come back and renegotiate? You bet it is. So I would say let's think about the idea of going back to, or maybe expanding upon our commissioners and have a board that's of seven people, most of whom are elected at the county level. Everybody gets to vote on them rather than district only. Will that satisfy Sharon Springs? Maybe not. I'd like to hear more about what Sharon Springs' current desires are versus what they used to be, because most of what their original desires are have been satisfied to some extent.
I'd like to correct something you said in the very first thing about schools. Your implication was that we've added all these schools and therefore that's addressed the overcrowding.
Yes.
All that is attempted to do is to keep up with the growth. The fact of the matter is that classrooms are more crowded than they've ever been. And so the building of new schools, again, is an attempt to deal with growth, but certainly the new schools have not shrunk school size or classroom size.
And where do you get that data, sir?
From my wife, who's a school teacher. And every year, she has more kids in her classroom. And every year, there are more kids, and they've added more teachers in the same square footage. She's at South Forsyth Middle School. So overcrowding has certainly not, we haven't gone in the other direction on the size of. Not at South Forsyth Middle School. Let me deal with that.
Well,
South Forsyth Middle School grows every year. They add teachers every year. The classroom sizes grow every year. And when they add new schools, that helps. But nothing has shrunk, at least in that middle school just down the street.
All right. The principle here is if you want to add a new school, you have to prove that the existing school is overcrowded. You have to prove that to the state in order to get a dollar from the state. And the state pays 40% of the cost.
Yeah, but pardon me, Frencher, the problem is that we're behind the curve. See, eventually, if growth stopped, that whole process may catch up. But the problem is the number of school-age kids coming in is faster than we can build schools. We can vote on getting the land and building them. So I'm not saying the process will not get us there. The problem is that it's not going as fast as the growth of school-age children coming in.
All right, I'm saying to you, school overcrowding as a generality, not as a specific school, okay? And the South Forsyth Middle may be a problem that way. I can't tell you, I can't speak to that. All I'm saying is the school system as a whole has redistricted, they've added new schools, and the overcrowding situation has diminished.
I don't believe it.
You're talking about one school.
I don't believe it. Well, countywide.
Here's what I would invite you to do.
I don't believe it.
I would invite you to call Christian Morrison, who is the Board of Education member from our area, and ask her the same question.
She spoke at Brookwood last week, and she said all of the high schools are grossly overloaded.
Yes.
And the best way to answer your question, sir, is number one, the funding comes from the state, right? We're all in agreement, and your behind the curve statement is probably correct. And we got behind the curve in 2008 when the real estate market balloon burst. state stopped funding because the counties couldn't justify any additional building because of the current situation. If you listen to Christine, she's blaming the state for the current situation we're in. And she said it's not going to change unless the funding formulas that are controlled by the state change in the future. And I was reading in an article, the governor just said that they're not going to address funding because it's too difficult and he's got a lot more important issues to address this year. So everything you said is correct, but remember where the money comes from and why it slowed down after 08 because of the real estate bust.
No, see, I agree with you. See, my point was that I believe it's a fallacy that school sizes overcrowding, right, is getting better. It is not. I'm not addressing the why. I'm not addressing the putting blame. But the fact of the matter is the schools in Forsyth County are not less crowded than they've ever been.
I would like to move out to a new subject. Okay. And get to the lady way in the back of the room, the patient.
Oh, thank you. What I was going to say is we've heard a lot about a lot of issues tonight. But what I came here to hear, and I don't know about everybody else, but I'm leaning towards no for Sharon Springs. After everything I've read and learned in the past 12 hours, I think I'm leaning more towards no. But the most important number that I've heard all night long was in the first 5 minutes of this meeting, and it was 17,000. And you said it's going to take 17,000 people to vote no. So while all of these issues that we're talking about need to be solved, yeah, we can have the best ideas in the world, but if we don't get 17,000 people to the polls to vote no, those ideas don't mean anything. We're getting a city.
Is there a luxury, man?
That's what I, that's my understanding.
We need to hire the Russians.
Right, so I mean, you got to, you know, yeah, short of hiring Russian collusion, you know, I don't know. I mean, I think we've got to develop a very, very clear, concise message. Don't, you know, we can't try to fix all of the world's ills in a message to get people to agree that maybe a city is not the solution.
Can I take a stab at answering the question right here? Now, I believe that when you want to know what someone's about, you look at what they do instead of what they say. And now when I look at this initiative here, what I just heard tonight and what I've seen so far through here is we have a group that's organized to get this through, who instead of going to the county commissioners, bypassed them and went to the state legislature. The group that says, I want to get representation and decisions down to the lowest possible level that actually represents the people, just did very opposite. Of that 159-3 in the state representatives, how many representatives actually have a stake in the proposed city of Sharon Springs?
One.
State Senate. The same way, that's the next step. Now, if I look at that, and we got all these representatives who don't have a stake here doing this to get it off the plate, I doubt that there's much chance that we're gonna have to impact the Senate, although I think it would be nice to go ahead and try to get some people up there to do that. But I agree that the key number is 17,000. So how do we do that? It seems to me that what we ought to do, I'm willing at the end here, follow your lead or whatever, but start a net here amongst us here today. I'm willing to leave my email address, phone number, so that as we get information, we can pass it out. But to me, the key thing is to get all of us concerned citizens to the place that can impact that 17,000. And the smartest way, it seems to me, is the homeowners associations located within the proposed city of Sharon Springs. We ought to have a group that puts together a presentation that starts going out next week, as fast as we can get it done, and ask for the ability to address each homeowner's board or to get a public meeting going there with facts. I think we've had a lot of information that has come up tonight. That's pretty good. I like the number the gentleman just raised here saying, we've just won 52% of the money for roads for the proposed city of Sharon Springs. Now, I don't think we're 52% of Forsyth County. So we got a bigger stake from that information right now today than if we put this proposed city of Sharon Springs together. Guess what? We're gonna be responsible for 100% of our roads.
Give me a little clarification there. 52% of the projects, not necessarily
projects, okay.
The
same. We can look at money. I mean,
one of the big projects, I'll tell you, is this Georgia 400 widening.
Okay. Well, I know the Atlanta Road widening.
Our delegation went down to the DOT, and they had an 11 o'clock meeting. This is in 2014. They were ushered into the conference room at 3, which was usual for them, as I understand it. They said, we want you to widen Georgia 400. And the DOT said, we have that on the agenda for 2024.
Okay. All right.
We spent $34 million on that one.
Okay. The point here, though, is to accumulate some of these facts in a concise way that we can reach out to the 17,000 voters through the Homeowners Association. Get a little working group together, maybe spread around information, come with ideas on how we can present this and start hitting the road and impacting that vote now. That would be my suggestion to address the question back here and to really do something that is going to take the very good initiative you put together and put it into overdrive and really make an effect.
I agree. Yeah. When I was talking, I forgot to talk about one thing. I had in this engagement process that I think we're trying to, the opposing Sharon Spring Group is trying to set up. One of the things is to take a look at it as a network of networks. In other words, we're talking about everybody sitting here who's been exposed to this, take away what you want. You have your own circle of friends, acquaintances, working business, whatever. And that network needs to get energized too. And the idea of us pushing the information out and making it available is one of the basic things that I think we're hoping to do. And Michelle is the person who's established the website, which has been up and running for 4 weeks now?
Three
weeks? Taking a lot of traffic. And I'd like to have her describe to you what she's seeing as activity, not only on the website, but also in the other social media that she monitored for.
Did you have your website?
Opposingsharonsprings.com. Yeah.
Could you talk up just a little bit?
I sure will.
Thank you very much.
I decided to do something about the new city. I couldn't think of a name. Opposing Sharon Springs just kind of made sense to me. So I started the website. It's kind of grown. We've taken blogs from people and posting social media to like Facebook, different groups, next door, reaching out, blogging, sending newsletters, asking people to subscribe to the newsletters, posting flyers on the website. So far, within 3 weeks, 2,000 people have visited the website. That's good. Over 1,000 people looked at one of my blog posts. So there is traffic being generated, but I need more. Whatever you guys have, if you have like a comment, whatever, if it's bullet points when you have your groups, if you want to post an event, I have no problem putting that on the website and sending it out through social media channels. If you have input or a blog or something you like, I would be more than happy to take a look at it. If you want to join the, like I said, the newsletter group, subscribe to the website. The only thing I can tell you is to share the flyers to your friends. Set up a meeting with your commissioner and your HOA group. If you want one of us to be there, we'll attend. Read the bill. I've got all the bills from the pro side, the con side. I've got all those maps, everything that I can find. I've got posted on the website. So there's a lot of information on opposingsharonsprings.com. And I do present both sides. Questions?
Good website.
How is it that there's no one here today for the pros?
There's at least two other meetings going on.
Tonight? How are they all picked today?
I did invite them, and I did have several email conversations with one gentleman. And he had a birthday appointment, and then the other two members that he said that he would ask to come had work engagements, so that they declined, they couldn't, they weren't available to come.
You're speaking of the Sharon Spring people? Water Commission.
Yeah. And not that I've made any definite decision, but I'd like to hear both sides.
Yeah, and I did. I reached out.
And I can truthfully both sides. Right. Somebody with absolute positive facts.
I mean, just had one thing here, and then I'll come to you. We are done until you speak. Then we're going to be done. The Board of Commissioners is going to have a town hall meeting at the Lanier Conference Center. And I believe the date is
February 27th at 6 p.m. It's on Ronald Reagan Boulevard.
And this, I would say, is the first town hall meeting that the Board of Commissioners has held in the whole time that this has been going on. There's been town hall meetings, but they were always held by the state representative, senator, and so forth. So I would encourage everyone to go to that meeting and take all your friends with you and pack that place up. And that would be the network that I would like to see work.
February 27th at 6 p.m. at the Lanier Tech, Forsyth County Conference Center at Lanier Tech. It's on Ronald Reagan, like behind the collections.
Right. They have the senior expo.
I'll be sending out a blast.
You're the last one.
I think one of the things that I was really upset about was that over at the Brookwood meeting, there were several people that asked for a town hall meeting for the Sharon Springs, you know, city. Pros and cons. And it was just like it was brushed under the rug and, oh, well, you know, we'll get to it when it's closer to the time. But that to me says something's going on behind the scenes. Somebody wants to snake something in without telling everybody. So I specifically asked, my neighborhood has no clue about this. Oh, we're going to sports events. We're going to, you know, public events. We're going to parks and services. And I said, the 27 people in my neighborhood have never heard about it. Only three have children, and they're not going to parks. So, we've been to the different subdivisions. I said, what about the subdivisions that have no soliciting signs? So to me, they really have not reached out to educate the people in the area about what's going on. And that's what's so frustrating. You can't hear, you know, what's going on, whether, you know, they're for or whether they're against together, because I think when you have a group of people, you know, people get information each way, and then they think of a different way to ask a question that people can relate to. But I mean, even at that meeting, people, you know, it was just like, oh, when it gets closer to the time. I even went on to the Sharon Springs Alliance website. I asked the same question. And then I get a, you know, response this long and, you know, why this, which that's fine. But I said, again, three times in there, we need a town hall meeting. And then, you know.
Hello, my name is Nydia Tisdale. I just wanted to let you know that I am video recording tonight's meeting, and it will be available on my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/Nydia Tisdale, spelled Nydia Tisdale. I am a citizen journalist, and I live in Roswell, Georgia. And good luck with your vote. I have no opinion either way. I thought this was a very interesting subject, and I wanted to educate the voters. As you suggested. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. As Michelle already said, the best thing is the social media. We met 3 or 4 weeks ago, 8 people. Now we got this. Phenomenal what social media will do.
Next
door. And that's the Facebook, Focus Oversight, HOA Oversight. All the things like that. Now the town hall meeting, I was here with Walmart trying to come in behind Laurel Springs. I live in Laurel Springs. We all showed up at the commission meeting in red. And that stood out like everything you cannot believe. When the commissioners look out and see a sea of red, they're going to know that we have strong opinions about it. So I encourage everybody to go to the town hall meeting and wear red.
Wear red. Wear 27.
Where's the town hall meeting?
Lanier Conference Center. Okay, good.
I think the biggest consensus is that, like you said, you brought up tons of different information. You've got to appeal to those 17,000 people. Like you said, a lot of those 17,000 people are people much younger than the people that are in here that have kids. That they are going to if you don't put together a precise argument of what is the city of Sharon Springs proposing pros, cons, and their holes and their suggestions, you're not going to get anywhere with those people because they're not going to go through blocks and blocks and blocks and blocks. They're going to say, oh, well, they're going to cut down on traffic, so therefore I'm going to vote yes. Does that make sense? So you need to come to the conclusion of you have some precise document with all of the arguments together that are more factual-based than opinion-based. You know, the increases in taxes, you know, stuff like that that's suggested. That is a vehicle that can be distributed to the HOAs, to the different school boards, to all of those different demographics of people, because you're not even addressing the fact that James Burgess is packed full of two elementary schools worth of kids, and nobody is represented here from that. So you have to make sure that what you're doing is appealing to the entire demographic of the area, and not just where the majority of the money is coming from, because you have a lot of people down there that are completely uneducated to what's even going on.
Exactly. I've been having a really hard time reaching out to that end of the footprint. Like, I'm having an easy time getting all over the south side,
right.
But I need help getting
those where all your kids are, and that's the majority of where you're going to have to pull your 17,000 from.
I know, but I need help.
So, but like I'm saying, yeah, you need to have some kind of condensed, even if it's a one document, this is what's proposed, this is what we don't agree with, or why this is not a good decision, because, you know, addressing the overcrowding of the schools is a state-funded money thing. Is the city of Sharon Springs going to fix that, yes or no? If the answer is no, then it becomes a moot point to the argument, and it goes back to the state. So that needs to be something that's addressed as well to all the members of the project in the area.
I gotta just add one more thing here. When I was talking with my wife, who's my editor in chief for everything that I put together, I told her that in order to make this thing move, you've got to get the women involved. When I saw Michelle over there, she's been working a lot, but a lot of this stuff is the women. My opinion, the women do things. My group, and there's a couple of guys from my group here, they just kind of sit around and talk. So the other thing I would say is as late as about 4 o'clock this afternoon, we had no idea who was gonna be here. My estimate was, well, it might be as low as 25. It might be 50. I'd say it's well over 100, and I couldn't guess a bigger number than that, but I certainly appreciate you all turning up. It's been worthwhile to help put this thing together.
Is there a reason they addressed the problems and mom's went to the other place first?
Can I just ask one quick question? Besides the name that you stated here,
is there any other meetings that you know of, or do you plan on having any meetings that have both sides present, as stated before, so that we can hear both sides? I mean, I'm pretty sure I know where I'm going with this, but I still like to be educated on what the plan is on both sides, and pros and cons, and hear from both ends.
The best prospect for that, I think, is this meeting you mentioned on the 27th of February 6th, at the Lanier Conference. That's being sponsored by the Board of Commissioners. First time they've done that since I've been watching this stuff go on. That's good. They've done a lot of other stuff, but they never tried to run a town hall meeting. And I suggest that's the next thing. Now, we're going to sit down on Monday. There's several people that are in this kind of core group of this opposing Sharon Springs, and try to assess where we think we should go. But we're going someplace. We've got time until May. There's a lot of people that don't know what's going on. They don't have any idea. We got a long ways to go. But the next big meeting is 27th February.
Hey, I will say that Representative Jones at the town hall did say that he was going to do a commitment to a Sharon Springs meeting specific to that, and that he would try to make it where that it was like both sides coming together. So Todd Jones, Representative Jones, did say that he would do that. Of course, he has been very neutral. He's been very good in this process, and I do think that he'll commit to that. He has not set a date yet, though.
Again, thanks everybody for coming.
I do need a big favor, if some of you strong backs can hang around a little bit, because I can't move on, so I'm going back. So get it back where it was. You don't mind taking out your shoes? I appreciate it.
If anybody wants to leave their email address, I have a pad up here, and I'll add it to the list.
Thank you for coming tonight. I appreciate the annoying that sometimes you don't see it when you walk in. I wanted to tell you when you came in that you're very welcome here tonight. And you're going to have a
good time. Did you guys have a good meeting? Good. No, I'm sure it was.
Hi, John. Our neighbor, he's
yes.
Behind us.
Yes. Yeah, and did you find out about the 19th?
Yes.
Okay.
And then you can come in.
Whatever you guys want. If the speaker gave us that day off.
I'm a property owner.
Yeah. So I thought of you. Anyways, I just want to let you know. Yeah. All right. Well, it's good seeing you. And you'll let me know about the 19th, please. Yeah. Just let me know what time. So is that definite? It's just we don't know what time.
What time?
Just let me know. Is it okay if I come?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to talk out of bed.
Poker time.
Okay. All right. I'm going to come in jeans and just a shirt, if that's okay.
Jeans and a t-shirt.
Yeah. That would be nice.
Yeah.
All right.
And they'll be glad to know you're our neighbor.
Nope. Absolutely. Happy to help.
All right.
Thanks, guys.
All right.
Hey, how you doing? I'm Todd Jones. Hi. Oh, no, I was at the Capitol. So, yes. So, just wearing, and then I went to a football meeting. Then here, and I'm going to try and catch the Forsyth County Republican meeting has a meeting tonight. And I think I missed the speakers, but maybe we're going to go to that happy hour. Oh, yeah, oh, I'm sorry. Yes, yeah. I am the only sign, correct?
But you can get in touch with me at Sharon Springs.
Let the judge
and I will call. Right, I will exactly. Contact you directly from the table here. Sorry about
there's one shot.
It's not
official.
Okay. Thank you so much.